afternoon. I'm Bev Hartline. I'm the Vice Chancellor for Research and the Dean of the Graduate School at Montana Tech. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to the first public lecture of our fall 2015 season, which is our third year of public lectures. And we are extremely pleased today to have with us Dr. Kelly Holley-Bockelmann from Vanderbilt University. But before I introduce Kelly, what I want to do is remind you that next week in the Natural Resources Building, room 128, we're hosting a talk by Shanwei Wang from Sun Yat-sen University in China, and he's going to be talking about the trend and dominant causes of water resource challenges in Central Asia. So that'll be same time, different place. Anyway, we're really delighted to have Kelly with us today. Kelly is an astronomer and astrophysicist. She got her bachelor's degree from Montana State and spent a few years before that with her family. They were living in Montana at the time. She moved on from Montana State to the University of Michigan, getting her PhD, I think, in astronomy. Mm-hmm. And then she had a postdoc at Penn State in College Station, Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
She's been at Vanderbilt now on the faculty for 8 years, where she won, probably very early in her time at Vanderbilt, she won a prestigious career grant from the National Science Foundation. And she is a Chancellor Faculty Fellow. Importantly for Montana Tech, she was also recently appointed the co-director of the Fisk Vanderbilt Master's to PhD Bridge Program, which mentors disadvantaged, underrepresented students to complete master's degree and prepare them for entry into competitive PhD program. That program happens to have a concentration in material science, and that's where we're potentially interested in partnering with Kelly and her colleagues. So she's joining us today to talk about growing the black hole in your own backyard, which we can see is quite a popular topic, though I don't imagine people ought to be doing it without supervision. So, Kelly, the floor is yours, and your mic is on.
Yep, I hope so. Is it on?
Yeah.
So, hi, folks. Thanks for having me here. I've had a really great time talking with the colleagues here and seeing all the lab facilities. Which is great because I'm mostly a theorist, so I don't tend to touch instruments. They didn't let me touch the instruments today either, so that's probably a good idea. So I just wanted to give you a heads up about how I like to do talks. I usually like them to be very interactive, so the way I'm going to think about this talk, and I hope that you do too, is that this is your opportunity to ask any burning question that you want about astrophysics, about black holes, about dark matter, in general. So I happen to have tenure already at Vanderbilt. It means they can't fire me if I can't answer one of your questions. So, and I also don't need to get to my research either. So we can take as much time doing some background stuff as you need and want. Okay. So the type of astronomer that I am is called a computational in-body mechanic. And so what that means is that when I want to study things about the universe, I tend to build fake models of those things with my supercomputer, and I run them for billions of years in computer time, but that's only a few months on in our time, just to figure out whether those theories that I have match observations. Okay? So a lot of my time, I'm building models of the galaxy, and I'm populating those galaxy models with N particles that are representing stars and black holes and their positions and their velocities. And then I'm following that with my supercomputer under gravity and a couple other bits of physics to see whether or not my ideas are true. So just I've got these folks who are involved in the research that I'm going to talk about today if I ever get to it. So I just wanted to give a shout out to all those awesome folks in my group. And I wanted to start out the very first thing to tell you my favorite definition of what a black hole is. You might have heard a bunch of different definitions of black holes, like a black hole is where the escape velocity is faster than the speed of light. So you may have heard of that before. And that's totally a valid way to describe a black hole. You may have heard ideas where you cram a bunch of matter and energy into a small enough place, you create a very dense region, and that region is a black hole. That's also a great way to describe a black hole. But here's my favorite way. It's that, and it goes with this weird idea that you gotta just accept, but once you do this, this will help, I think. And that is this concept that matter, you, me, our sun, everything with matter, fundamentally bends space-time. Okay? So you and I don't bend space-time that much, because we're not that massive, even if we eat a lot of pie. But things that are very massive bend space-time a lot. And if you're very compact and very massive, the bend in space-time that you make will be very sharp. Okay? So you and I bend space-time in a rather shallow way. A black hole is so dense and compact that the curvature in space-time that you introduce, the bend in space-time that you introduce, has a bend that is formally infinite. Down here would be the singularity of the black hole. And the reason why we call it a black hole is that it takes forever for a photon, a light particle, emitted right here to travel up this bit of space-time and out into normal flat space where you can observe it. Okay? Because light can only travel on space-time, and this is actually what the space-time does. So this naturally gives you this idea that the escape velocity would be faster than the speed of light. What that really just means is that it takes an infinite amount of time for light, or anybody, to go out into normal space. Okay. So we're going to use that concept of black holes being a really sharp curvature in space-time the rest of this talk. And I will just tell you, we know for sure, as astronomers, that there's two types of black holes. So what you just saw is a really cool picture, I think, of one type of black hole, which is called a stellar mass black hole. So when our sun starts to die, and it's going to die in about 5 billion years, what will happen is it puffs up. And it will puff up so much that the Earth will be inside of the sun. So we're all going to be fried, and it's not going to be a happy time. But if the sun were more massive, like about 10 times the mass of the sun, then it would have a rather catastrophic death. It'll explode. And I always like this because it's got that little planet right there, which is totally blasted by this catastrophic supernova explosion. And what is left behind is a massive, maybe 10 solar mass object that can no longer support itself by emitting light. And so the matter just collapses in on itself. Its mass, it's now small, its curvature in space-time is now super sharp, and you're left with a black hole. So those kinds of black holes are rife throughout the universe. We've got approximately 100 million of those in our own galaxy right now, just floating throughout the galaxy. And they're a natural consequence of massive star evolution. And we've seen them, and a couple of really famous examples are Cygnus X1 in the constellation of Cygnus, which is a beautiful summer constellation. If you look up there, you won't see it because it emits strongly in X-rays as matter is swirling around, falling into this black hole and getting really hot. If we had X-ray eyes, we'd be able to see it. But there's another kind of black hole that has just gotten, maybe in the past 20 years, more credence. We're sure that they exist, and it was a surprise, but we now know for sure that there is a supermassive black hole that has a mass that's millions to billions of times the sun that sits right smack in the center of a galaxy. Okay? And those are the ones I like to study. By the way, if you have questions at any time, please stop me. Sometimes I'll use jargon, and you can just ask questions at any time, okay? This picture, by the way, is the Andromeda galaxy, and it's our neighbor galaxy. A typical galaxy has, 100 billion stars in it, about 100 billion planets in them, we now know. The past 2 or 3 years, we've realized that there are just as many planets in a galaxy as there are stars. There's gas, there's dust, there are, right, 100 million of those tiny black holes that I was talking about. At the center is a supermassive black hole. And suffusing all of this is the coolest thing ever, which is a giant sea of dark matter. I don't know if you've heard of dark matter before, but dark matter is, well, nobody really knows what it is, but we think it's a subatomic particle that just doesn't interact with normal matter much at all. The average time between interactions of a dark matter particle with another particle is the age of the universe. So they're really, really not interacting much. But they make up 95% of the matter of the universe. So most of a galaxy, if you're talking about the matter of the galaxy, the gravity of the galaxy, the content of the galaxy, is dark matter. And we're not seeing it at all here. Okay? So it's about over 90% of the matter in a galaxy. But the size here is crazy. So here's the galactic disk. And the dark matter halo for a single galaxy would go all the way past this one. And that's one galaxy. So the sea of dark matter that surrounds and controls the motion of stars in a galaxy is mostly what theorists like me want to build. If I want to build a galaxy and I ignore dark matter, then I'm really ignoring most of the galaxy. I just wanted to let you know that kind of thing because I'm going to be talking about dark matter a bunch. And just to let you know, for me, dark matter is synonymous with the galaxy. So another fun fact. Sorry, I got to tell you all kinds of fun facts, even before I get to any of the research. Hold your hand out now. Okay, you don't have to. But if you want to hold your hand out now, there are hundreds of billions of dark matter particles coming from the ambient universe through your hand, through the center of this building, center of the Earth, and out again. Every second. Every single second. You are bombarded with hundreds of millions of dark matter particles. They don't interact with you, but they're there. Kind of cool stuff. Yeah?
They don't interact with
anything
over there.
Oh man, that's a whole other talk. But I can tell you some ways. So we know Newtonian gravity works. Well, actually, we know general relativity works. But anyway, we know gravity works. And so we know, for example, the motion of stars in a galaxy is moving faster than just the total amount of matter that we can see. So there's got to be some invisible matter there. And so we can tell by the motion of the stars in a galaxy and how they rotate around the center of the galaxy that the total content of matter is much larger. There are many other ways that we know that there's dark matter in there. Everything from the microwave background radiation from early in the universe, the echoes of the Big Bang, it echoes in a certain way that tells us that there's dark matter. So we have lots of evidence from a whole bunch of observations that dark matter must exist, but you're right, we've never observed it. And that's what the particle physicists are going to be doing, and I hope they do it pretty soon, because it would be really exciting to know what particle that is flying through us all the time. Okay. But back to black holes. Black holes set at the center of each galaxy. And okay, this is a plot, and sorry for those of you who don't see plots very often. I'm going to walk you through this. It's not a horrible plot. And at the end of the day, the only thing I want you to know is that this is the centerpiece of a giant mystery for us folks who are in the black hole business. Okay, I'm going to walk you through it. So the big deal is we found black hole in our galaxy. We found black holes in other galaxies, and astronomers can never travel to these things. So what we try to do if we want to understand the underlying laws of physics that control why they're there, astronomers will basically take a bunch of data, and then they'll plot every physical quantity against every other physical quantity. And then the two physical quantities that have the tightest correlation tells you something about the underlying physics. And so they did that, just to plot everything against everything else, and let's see what pops up, okay? And when they did, they found this. This is the mass of the black hole, and this is what is called the velocity dispersion at the edge of the galaxy. Basically, like how disordered the velocity is at the edge of the galaxy, okay? Like, for example, if you're moving down a river and the current is really nice and you're moving in an orderly way, that has low velocity dispersion. If you're visiting a swarm of bees and they're really mad, that has high velocity dispersion. The bees are all moving all wonky, okay? So high velocity dispersion means wonky motions of stars. Low velocity dispersion, everybody's moving in an orderly way. And that was the thing that had the highest correlation, crazy pants. So these are individual galaxy measurements, and the little ellipses are pretty, that's why I showed it, but they show you the error in the estimates of the black hole mass. So one cool thing to remember is astronomers can never travel to these places, and so sometimes we have order of magnitude error bars, a factor of over 10 guess in the black hole mass. That's the best we can do. And so we don't know these masses of the black holes in the centers of these galaxies very accurately, but we know them to within a factor of 10. So bottom here is a million solar masses. The top is 10 to the 10 solar masses of black holes. And so the thing we noticed about that was that there was a correlation between the black hole mass in the galaxy and the star's motion at the edge of the galaxy. And here's why that's profound. So remember I told you that black holes are this infinite curvature of space-time stuff, right? Okay, that place in a galaxy for a Milky Way mass black hole, which is about a million solar masses, that place is called the Schwarzschild radius. And it's about the size of the Earth, the distance between the Earth and the Sun. Okay, so basically if you go close enough to the supermassive black hole at the center of our galaxy as the distance between the Earth and the Sun, you'll get sucked in. If you're out of that, it's fine. You don't notice you're in flat space. So anyway, that's about the distance between the Earth and the Sun. The place where the black hole dominates the gravity is about 1 parsec. A parsec is about 3 light years, okay? And that's about the distance between us and the nearest star. And the place where you're measuring this stellar motion stuff is thousands of parsecs, way at the edge of the galaxy. So those two distances are completely decoupled. The black hole shouldn't know about the stars at the edge of the galaxy. The stars at the edge of the galaxy are moving in a certain way because there's a black hole at the center, and it shouldn't. The black hole's a tiny part of the matter. It's a tiny a physical size compared to the galaxy. So this is our biggest mystery. We found this correlation, and now we're trying to figure out why this is happening. We don't know for sure. We have some theories, but part of my job is to help build the theories and test them with supercomputers, okay? I'm not going to solve that problem today because it's unsolved right now, but I'll tell you some ideas. One idea in general is that black holes should grow in lockstep with their host galaxies, okay? So just take that thought. Yeah. Just some other cool things that are very recent. So astronomers also like to generalize. So we found these black holes and this correlation in a couple of galaxies, and then we said, well, every galaxy has a black hole, and all the galaxies follow along this correlation, and be careful. Astronomers generalize way too much. Here are some black holes that have just been found that are not on this correlation. Here's this teeny tiny galaxy right here called NGC 1277. It sits in a cluster of galaxies. Look at all these beautiful galaxies here. Everything that doesn't have a little spike on it is a galaxy, each of which has 100 million stars and a black hole and planets and gas and dark matter, right? This little guy has a black hole that is 17 billion masses. He is way off the chart here. Plonk, 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 completely off of the correlation. So we're trying to understand how that happened. And then there's new stuff, too, on the small mass end. This is a tiny, tiny dwarf galaxy, and it's got a million solar mass black hole in it, just like our galaxy, but it's a teeny tiny galaxy. So jury's still out about how general this correlation is, but the fact that we found this for normal-sized galaxies is pretty cool. Okay, so if I'm an anybody, if I'm a theorist, and I want to tell you about how black holes grow, like the black hole in our own backyard, the Milky Way, black hole that is 4 million solar masses, I need to start talking about how black holes grow in general within galaxies, okay? So I'm gonna basically walk you through some dynamics, some gravitational physics that lets you know
how black holes grow. Here's one cool part. The first stage is that if there's a black hole in each galaxy, then one thing we know is that galaxies grow by smashing together and becoming a larger object. For example, remember that Andromeda galaxy that I showed you? It's our neighbor galaxy, and in a few billion years, it's going to collide with us. So our planet will already be crispy fried by then, so we don't have to worry. But one nifty thing about that is that each individual star is so far apart that no stars are going to collide. You'll just get this weird shaped galaxy like this. Here's a picture of a galaxy merger that's currently happening. Two galaxies are on a crash course. They have collided. They are now making, here's the two nuclei of the galaxy, and long, long, long tails called tidal tails, where the gravitational pull is pulling stars out into weird shapes and exciting a bunch of star formation at the center. So here's a ground-based picture, and then here's the Hubble Space Telescope zoom in here, where you can see it's kind of a mess. There's swirling gas, there's a bunch of dust. Things are happening to make new stars because everything's colliding. And that happens in the lifetime of every galaxy. That is one way in which galaxies grow. In that case, the black holes themselves are separated by about 1 megaparsec. That's the distance between us and the nearest galaxy cluster. Okay? Really, really huge distance. And the time scale that that takes for the black holes to come together into one galaxy is about 100 million years. Okay? And the physics that governs that is this thing called dynamical friction, which I can talk to you about later if you'd like. But I want to show you a movie. Here's a movie of two equal mass galaxies using a supercomputer with dark matter, with stars, with gas. You see the pink stuff is hot gas. You'll see that they went through one pass. You'll see that little yellow stuff. This is hot gas that gets heated up because as the gas falls into the black hole, it moves faster and faster, collides with one another, and just gets hot. You've got a giant mess right now as the two galaxies are trying to form one. And the feedback, the radiation from that black hole process has blown away a bunch of gas really rapidly. And when that gas cools out on the edge of the galaxy and makes stars, those stars are going to have wonky velocities. And so this is one of the early, early ways that people were describing how you can get a relation between the black hole growing and that velocity dispersion at the edge of the galaxy. Basically, galaxies collide, the black holes start to collide, they start to eat gas, they push gas out. When the gas cools, it's way out at the edge, and it's moving fast. Okay? As it turns out, that's not perfect, but you know, it gets you a good way towards the right answer. And we got there through these simulations. Okay, but the cool thing that happens next is that the two black holes are now at the center of this new galaxy merger remnant, and they sink to the center, and then they become a binary orbiting around the galactic center. And the only way that they can get closer together is by flinging stars out. So once you fling a star out, you take energy away from this binary system, and it gets closer. Throw another star out, gets closer. So those two black holes need to keep flinging stars out in order to get close enough to merge together. Okay? That physics is called three-body scattering, and it can take a really long time. So in fact, if you run out of stars to throw out, the two black holes will stall as a binary black hole at the center of the galaxy, and your black hole won't grow. It won't become like the Milky Way black hole at all. This is a big problem. And for decades, we tried to solve this problem with theory and with computer simulations to try and make those black holes get close enough so that they can pass on to the next stage of physics. But in this case, my group helped solve this problem because we realized that everybody was simulating galaxies really simply. They were making spherical-shaped galaxies that were static and didn't have gas and didn't do all the things that real galaxies do. So once you make the galaxies more realistic, there's naturally enough stars to throw out, and the black holes move on to this next stage. Okay, the next stage is, okay, the black holes are really, really close. How close are they? They're as close as the distance between the Earth and the Sun, okay? And they're orbiting around each other at relativistic speeds, millions of times a second, okay? And they, at that point, do something fantastic. So remember I told you that black holes make bends in space-time, right? Well, when something is moving, like this, you do this, you're making a ripple in space-time that propagates all throughout the universe. This makes a gravitational wave, which is a bend in space-time that propagates out through everywhere. It's so weird, because what that actually does is it bends, because it's space-time itself, it moves the distance between you and me back and forth. The size of you and me, back and forth. Okay? That thing exists everywhere. Doing this makes a gravitational wave. I know I said that 8 million times, but it's because it's, whoa, kind of profound. Well, when the two black holes get close together, remember, they make big bends in space-time. And when they orbit around each other, they make the strongest gravitational wave in the whole universe. Okay? And waves, like electromagnetic waves, like light, they carry away energy. So when you do this, you carry away energy from your system. You have less mass now. I should do this a whole bunch, right? So when black holes do this, they carry away energy from their orbit, and they merge. Okay, that's called the gravitational wave regime. And I want to show you the sound of two black holes merging. Do you want to hear the sound of two black holes merging? Okay, so what we've done is we've translated the motion of the black holes around. This makes a frequency, and we just played a sound of it, sound bite of it. Okay? So I'm gonna do that. Oops. Okay, that was the sound of two. Okay, so now I know that you guys all aren't 8-year-old boys. Because the 8-year-old boys all laugh at the beginning part because it sounds like a fart. And all the people who are not 8-year-old boys laugh at the last little chirp part. So what just happened there? Well, you started with the two black holes orbiting at some constant rate, and the gravitational radiation wasn't very strong. They had basically the same frequency, but slowly and slowly the pitch started getting higher and higher, and pretty soon they were so close together that they were such strong gravitational wave emitters that the frequency changed quickly. So you heard bloop right when they merged. Okay? That should happen in our universe all the time. We've never detected gravitational waves. We know they exist, and I can tell you some reasons why we think they exist if you're interested, but that's one of our major efforts in the next decade, is to try and detect gravitational radiation. It would be so cool to be able to detect these gravitational waves, because then it opens up a whole new window to the universe. A window that's gravitational rather than electromagnetic. You know all the discoveries we've made with x-rays and gamma rays and radio waves and visible light. Who knows what we're gonna discover if we open up the gravitational wave spectrum. So I can't wait until we're in that era. And I hope we can all see it. Oh, so one tiny little thing. Can I geek out about computer codes for just a second? Okay, so I used to make a joke at Penn State, which where folks did this type, they tried to simulate this type of process of two black holes in this phase merging together, and they had to do GR types of equations, general relativity types of equations, where they modeled space-time itself. And they did it, and they kept getting money to do this. And for 30 years, they'd place the two black holes together, and they'd start their computer codes, and their computer codes would crash. And then they'd try it, and it would still crash. And then they get some more money from people, and it would crash again. For 30 years, this problem of getting two black holes to merge in computer codes never happened. Now, did we think they actually merged in reality? Yes, but we could never do it with our computer codes until about 2007. And I was at Penn State at a time, and it was so cool to see this paradigm shift of people finally being able to solve a problem. And here's what they did. So this is a computer code of space-time. And they did something really awesome, which is that they, the whole problem here is that, remember, black holes are an infinite curvature in space-time. Computers hate infinities. If they see an infinity, they crash. But a black hole is an infinity, so how do you do the black holes? Well, these people decided, I'm going to build a mesh that increases in the fineness of the mesh as we get closer to the black hole, but I'm going to stick the black hole not at the mesh point. So the computer never sees a formal infinity, it sees a big number, and computers can handle big numbers, they just don't like infinities. And as long as you do that, you're fine. Now, it sounds like an obvious thing, but we had to wait until technology could catch up that we could actually do this thing that seems pretty obvious now. So now that we did the mesh, we're going to do the two black holes merging, and what you're seeing in those psychedelic colors are the ripples in space-time. One up, one down, I think pink is up, and like yellow is down. So those are ripples in space-time that are propagating away from this system throughout the universe, ready for us to detect. If we just had a detector. And then notice that the black hole merged together, it makes a little peanut for a second, and then it will wobble down into a single black hole. This happens at a fraction of a second. So this is not a long process. This is black hole merging super quick. Okay. So the thing is, at Penn State, when people did this study, and when everybody tries to do computer studies, you first try and pick the problem as simple as possible, right? You don't want to start off with a super complicated problem. You want to just pick the simplest problem and see if you can solve that. And so that's what these folks did. They picked two equal mass black holes that don't spin around, that orbit each other on a circle, and then move it together. That was the movie that you saw. But as soon as they got the computer code to work, they decided, aha, nature's not going to give us all that kind of simplicity. Let's build black holes that have spins, that spin in different orientations, that have different masses, etc. And then they found a big surprise, something they never would have predicted with their pencil and paper. And it's this. If the merger of the two black holes is not perfect, so for example, if you have one giant black hole and one little black hole, or if the orbit of the two black holes comes in kind of on an eccentric orbit rather than a circle, then the gravitational waves that are made aren't perfectly symmetric either. They're stronger on one side than on another. And I don't know why I do this, because it's not a good analogy, but the analogy I always think at this point is like when you make your bed and you ripple that sheet, there's a ripple that propagates, right? Just in one direction. That's what happens in this case. You get a ripple in space-time that's preferential in one direction and not, and what that does is it moves the black hole, because that's space-time, off in one direction, like a shot, like a bullet. And nobody predicted that. It's kind of obvious afterwards. And the speed of those black holes is like 4,000 kilometers a second. That is so fast that it's faster than the escape velocity of anything in the universe. The most massive supercluster in the universe can't hold on to these black holes when they're kicked out. So we started off with this idea of, hey, black holes grow by merging together, and then the gas flow, blah, 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 that stuff. But now we've just found a surprise. If galaxies grow by merging together, and if the black hole merger isn't perfect, then the black hole gets shot off in some weird direction. So how do galaxies keep their black holes? We don't know yet. But I did a study about that, and so I can tell you about that later. But in order to do that, I had to build a little fake part of the universe, and put black holes in them and make them grow in the way that I thought that they would grow, and then analyze the result. And when we did, we found some cool stuff. So we found these cool things. Sorry, there's a plot, so I'm just going to tell you about the plot. We found some cool results in growing the Milky Way black hole. Our Milky Way black hole undergoes lots and lots of mergers with other little galaxies with their own little black holes. Okay? So our Milky Way, how we build it, is from the merger of a lot of tiny black holes over time. This makes sense because we're pretty sure that our galaxy didn't grow by a major merger. It created a bunch of small galaxies, so it kind of makes sense. And when that happens, all along the way, there are some tiny galaxies that kind of never make it to our galactic center. They're still outside in orbiting around our galaxy. And they should have small black holes in them, floating around in our galaxy. And we call those, I think, slowly sinking black holes. So they should be black holes that are 10,000 solar masses, a new type of black hole called an intermediate mass black hole, neither the stellar mass black hole or the supermassive black hole, but it's in tiny little galaxies that are orbiting around our own, just from the remnants of galaxy mergers that haven't finished yet. Okay? They're going to merge with us in the future, but they haven't yet. So we made a prediction that those should exist. And it's kind of a crazy prediction, but recently we found, astronomers have found a object called a hyperluminous X-ray source 1. And what they think it is, we don't name things very smart, we're kind of silly about that. What we think it is a small black hole of that intermediate class floating around in the outskirts of a galaxy. So here's some evidence, tangential, but evidence that this kind of process may occur. Okay. And the last class that we found were these. I'm trying to find a good picture because I don't want to show you plot. Oh, well, never mind. I will show you this pretty plot. There we go. You can look at this pretty plot while I explain this different thing. Sorry. Okay, so we found another kind where the black holes are kicked out, right? So this slingshot effect of those black holes happening and they get thrown out probably happens all the time in every galaxy. Our black hole was just made of the ones that stayed. So we made another prediction, is that the universe should be full of these rogue black holes that are floating through intergalactic space that got shot out during the normal assembly of every supermassive black hole because of these mergers. Okay, so we found out a bunch of things through simulations here. We found out in growing our own Milky Way black hole in a Milky Way type galaxy that we have small, tiny galaxy mergers, and those things make our Milky Way black hole. The last little bit I'm going to show you is new stuff that we're doing. We're basically making a little slice of the universe and adding gas to the simulation and allowing the one galaxy to grow. What you're seeing is a dark matter background. You're not able to see it, but the gas falls in along the dark matter and slowly builds up a galaxy. You'll see a lot of smashing together stuff happening. Those are galaxy mergers, each with their small black holes colliding together. Some of them are tossed out. Some of them are not. The gas keeps funneling in along these dark matter fans that you can't see and building up slowly a galactic disk. The blue are young stars that are still accreting gas here. And finally, that black hole we studied and said, what did you eat along the way? So this takes a long time. In real time, this took it took 10 million supercomputer hours to do, which is a few months of physical time. So there's a Milky Way mass galaxy with a Milky Way mass black hole. And let's see. Come chat with me about a bunch of other things if you would like, but right now I think it's best to just take questions. Thank you very much for your attention. I really appreciate it. Okay.
Yeah, you're making all these studies and predictions based on computer models.
Yes.
when we make a computer model, one of the ways we verify that it's correct is against some actual physical object. And
yep.
In your case, you don't have any such physical objects. So how do you know What processes do you do to assure that your computer code is correct?
This is a really great question. What we do is we verify the masses of the black holes that we get with observational data of the masses of the black holes in galaxies. So we are able to check our results with actual observational data. Thank goodness, because otherwise we could just be making up stuff, right? So in fact, often we do make up stuff, and then we run our computer simulation and it looks nothing like reality. Like the number of stars is way too wrong, or the black hole mass is like 12. So we know we've screwed up. We have to match it against data. You're absolutely right. Yes, hi.
Well, I'm not clear about when the galaxy forms in the beginning, just how the black hole, its original black hole.
Oh, that's a great question. We don't know. So I can tell you two theories, and I'm working on it. So I've got some students working on that now, and there's two theories. Both of them might be wrong. The first theory is that there's this special type of star way early in the universe when the gas is so pristine. It's called a population 3 star, again, because astronomers are horrible at naming things. Donuts. It's a population 1 star, and it's a special type of star. It's very, very big and bloated, and it has masses of 1,000 solar masses, let's say. And it lives just for an instant and leaves behind a black hole. That black hole has a mass of a couple hundred solar masses, and then you dump gas along, and then slowly you start to grow. Now, there's a huge problem with that. And that is, we know that there are black holes in these things called quasars at redshift 6. And that means a billion years after the Big Bang. So how do you get a little tiny 100 solar mass black hole to get to be a billion solar masses in just a billion years? We have to stretch some of our current understanding to do that. So there's one idea. That's called the light seed theory. And in my opinion, the light seed theory works for little galaxies like our own. There's another theory that's called the direct collapse black hole, and it makes bigger black holes, about 100,000 solar mass black holes. And what that is just you have these large dark matter halos, and you have that pristine gas that we were talking about, and you also have this ambient radiation field, whatever. But the gas just slowly, slowly cools down. It hasn't happened to make a star because of some special like chemistry stuff. But it just slowly, slowly gets very dense and then makes a black hole. That's kind of hand-wavy. But that's called the direct collapse black hole formation. And it makes big seeds. That is, having bigger seeds makes it easier to get those massive black holes early on. Time will tell which one is right. I think maybe it's neither of those. But we'll see. That is an excellent question. Yes, hi.
A few slides ago, we saw a modeling of a universe similar to the Milky Way coming together.
Yeah.
When black holes are kicked out, are they bound to the same constraints as they travel to go through the dark matter as we saw the dense matter traveling together?
Absolutely, yes. But the thing is, if they're kicked out at 4,000 kilometers a second, the dark matter halo is not even going to slow them down. It's not massive enough. But there are some black holes, actually, that get kicked out at, let's say, 100 kilometers a second, and they're still bound to the halo. They'll go way out of the galaxy, and then the dark matter halo slows them down because it's got enough mass. So they'll go way out, and then they'll slam back into the galactic center. So that's a really great question. The dark matter halo controls all of the motion, basically, of all of the matter in a galaxy. So, good question. Yeah?
So, you had that graph which showed the nicest correlation.
Sorry.
They were both log scales.
Yes.
They're both log scales on both sides.
Yes. And they both had huge error bars.
Anything will be a straight line on a log scale.
Totally right.
But, you talked about, and then you sort of were explaining that velocity dispersion around the edge because of the extreme messes that are created when you have these violent collisions going on and developing. So we've got a universe which is, 13 to 18 billion years old, been going around for a while. So if you look at the galaxies that are out there, including with the dispersions and less dispersion, are people thinking like they're just two,
black holes that collided to make them, or are there 100, or are there 12?
That's another great question. So a galaxy's life is punctuated with mergers. To make the Milky Way mass black hole in our simulation, we had 100 mergers. They were just tiny mergers. To make the merger of the movie that I showed you was one equal mass merger, two behemoth galaxies slamming together. That's rare, but large galaxies undergo lots of those. To make our Milky Way mass black hole, we estimated there were like 100 black holes, that small black holes that participated in that event. So yeah, there's lots of these events happening.
And I
want to
follow up
with
you regarding that graph also.
Yes.
So you talked about redshift 6,
yeah,
and all. So those galaxies, black holes that are along that line,
yeah,
are they all ages from redshifts of 6 down to brand new, or are they?
Mm-hmm. No, those galaxies were all gold standard galaxies picked locally to be not messy, to have no weird kinematics in them, no weird velocities going around, no weird motions, and they were all local so that you could get the black hole masses very accurately. Sorry, I know that there were order of magnitude error bars, but all with Hubble Space Telescope. So we don't know what the M sigma was, we don't know what that correlation looks like at early on in the universe. We also don't know what it looks like for regular galaxies that aren't perfect, like the ones that we picked. So I realize I'm giving you a lot of things to like that are grains of salt, but that's the way astronomy is. We are doing our very best to get those masses, and they're still not accurate because we can never go to them. So we have to deal with what we've got. Yeah. Okay.
I'm just curious what happens in the threshold between something that is not a black hole and is a black hole. And the black hole, you get a star that was right on the threshold of becoming a black hole,
yes.
A black hole forming inside a black hole.
Can a black hole form inside a black hole? I don't know, because we don't know what's inside of a black hole. But what we think is that once matter is added to that, the place where the infinite curvature is, that's called the event horizon. Once matter is added to that, the black hole itself just grows and the event horizon is just larger. Okay. But once we're inside the event horizon, supposedly, no real information is going to get out, so we don't know what happens inside there, whether there's a black hole in there or not, probably not. But you were saying, what's at that intermediary between a black hole?
Right.
So there's this cool object.
What's a small black hole?
Okay, in the meantime, I'm going to see if there's if I can answer another question. You got a question? I'm going to show you a movie. Go ahead, I can take your question.
Oh.
I got to pull this movie up, which is kind of fun.
Pretty well answered it, but I was going to ask you, about the event horizon, the bringing material into the black hole.
Mm-hmm. So what happens there?
Yes, well, once stuff gets into the black hole, mm-hmm, the horizon, it can't get out.
Yeah, that's...
It's under the black hole.
It's really true that what happens there, as far as we know, what happens there is that the matter simply goes inside the event horizon, inside that place that has an infinite curvature, and any information that we would have about that, whether it was hamburgers that fell in or, you know, subatomic particles that fell in, all that information is lost.
But the black holes grow by accreting.
But they grow by accreting matter. So we know that something fell in. We don't know that hamburgers fell in or potato chips, but we know that certain amount of matter fell in because the event horizon itself gets bigger.
But if it expels stars before it emerged, then the stars maintain their individuality, then it don't have a hamburger potato chip.
That's because that flinging stars out phase happens when you're basically in flat space. Those black holes are really far apart compared to
the
singularity.
The stars are commingling within the black hole.
They're not commingling within the black hole. They're passing like, here's the two black holes, and the stars kind of thread the needle between the two black holes as they orbit around, still in flat space, but the energy of that orbit is still enough to fling the star out.
So each of the black holes has a galaxy of a lot of stars around it.
Yes.
It's a galaxy of stars that some of them are being
That it's the central nucleus of the galaxy that is available for the black holes to fling out.
Well, it's not actually flinging the star out of the black hole.
Not out of the black hole. Oh my gosh, no. Out of the galaxy. Sorry.
So where does it go once it goes out from the...
So that's cool, because you can fling those stars out at like 700, 1,000 kilometers a second. So those things are called hypervelocity stars. And so we did a study with one of my students, who was in that first picture, to kind of look for stars in the Milky Way that were flung out, and we found some. So that was evidence that there was this process going on a long time ago. Yeah?
Fucking believe the news lately.
Yeah.
How does that affect some of the things you're talking about?
I don't think it affects a lot, but let me just tell you, I'm not a GR person. I deal mostly in flat space, and I talk to GR people, and I take their results and incorporate them in my stuff. But I think what he's saying, anybody who is an expert can correct me, because, fine. What I think is saying is that if you have, so this cool thing happens in space-time. Basically, every second, billions of particles are created and destroyed. Like, space-time is not only this bendy, warpy thing, but it's this frothy thing. I always think of the froth. Because particles are created and destroyed all the time. It's like fizzy. But right near the event horizon of a black hole, you can form a subatomic particle pair, and it wants to collide and just go away, but one falls into the black hole and one doesn't. Okay, so that's called Hawking radiation, because eventually you bleed away mass, essentially. Weird, but true. I think he's saying now that you can get information out of a black hole because you know you could technically know whether a particle or a subatomic particle was emitted. Now, you're not going to get information about cheeseburgers in that way. You're just going to know, an antiparticle was emitted this time, and this time a not antiparticle was emitted. So that kind of information, I think he's talking about. But that doesn't really affect us. Oh, I want to show you. I want to get back to showing you this one little. Try not to cuss. I know that there's people. Okay, well, let's take some more questions while I try and find this awesome movie. Okay, so the movie that I'm going to try and set up for you is what would happen for very small black holes. Do you guys remember the big particle collider recently that was in Zurich? Okay, lots of people protested and said, please, don't make this particle collider, because what you're going to do is you're going to make itty-bitty black holes that are about the size of a proton, and they're going to sink to the center of the Earth, and they're going to eat the Earth. So that was a big deal. It was fun to talk about. I know I have a picture of it, but I have a little YouTube video of that process happening. So you were talking about what's the smallest black hole. The smallest black hole would be made. Oh, here it is. Oh, but it's got to convert the movies. Okay, so the smallest, basically when you pack matter or energy into a small, tiny area, it's very dense, and so space-time curves a lot. So a particle collider smashes together stuff and would make matter and energy in a really, really tiny area. That could make a black hole. In this one weird theory of, it's converting seven. One weird theory of space-time that happens to involve, like, I think 11 dimensions and whatever. Anyway, that's not true. That theory didn't happen. What would happen is that those black holes would immediately evaporate due to this Hawking radiation stuff. And also the event horizon of the place where the black hole eats is so small, it's smaller than a proton. What could it eat? It couldn't eat a proton. So how is it going to eat the Earth? So anyway, that was the whole idea. And I just have a cute YouTube video showing the Earth being sucked up. Maybe it'll play. Yes?
Do you know how exactly they're going about trying to detect those gravity waves you were talking about?
Yes.
Can you explain that more?
Yes. Yes. So remember, gravitational radiation basically stretches and shrinks the distance between you and me. And so what people have done, and they've done this already, is that they build these long things called interferometers. Basically, these things just track the distance between you and me with lasers. And they track distance in terms of time. So we know the speed of light has a certain speed, and so we take a stopwatch and we say, okay,
wouldn't light bend with the gravity wave?
So we would notice a difference in the distance between you and me. And we'd notice, so if we put them at right angles to each other, one arm will be longer and one arm will be shorter in a characteristic way. And so we're looking for that exact thing. But it's so hard because, it's super hard to do, because you're looking for a bend in space-time. I think that's, I can't remember the size now. Oh, but it's ridiculously small. And what will happen is that there's trucks that will cause the lasers to move back and forth, and they'll think, oh, it's a gravitational wave, and it's not at all. Or there was one time a plane that flew over and made a sonic boom.
Could you do it in space?
Yes, you could. That was this beautiful thing called LISA, and NASA doesn't have enough money to... I'm so sad, because that for sure will detect gravitational waves no matter what, because there's this pulsar that we know for sure, and it's gravitational range. And this guy, two guys called Pulse and Taylor, got Nobel Prizes for it. Okay, I'm going to show you. Any more questions? It's very realistic because it's found on the internet. So those little proton-sized black holes are going to sink to the center of the Earth. They're going to stop, which, by the way, no. And they're going to all of a sudden eat the whole Earth in this very beautiful way, which also no. Okay, sorry. It's hot too. I'm a sucker for these kind of things. Okay, so that didn't happen. Okay, are there any more questions? Well, I'm going to be here for a while, so if you have questions, you're welcome to come up. Thank you so much for your attention.
Well, thank you very much.